you step down into darkness. Open my eyes, let me see beauty that made this heart adore you. Hope of a life spent with you. Here I am to worship, here I am to bow down, here I am to say that you're my God. You're altogether lovely, altogether worthy, altogether wonderful to me.
To get everything, I'm pushing the wrong buttons at the wrong time in the wrong place. But at least I got them pushed right finally. Good morning to everybody. Oh, I just love the way some mornings start out for me. They start out great and then, you know, my fingers get in the way of what I'm doing. So, good morning, good morning. Hail, hail, hail. The gang is assembling. Good morning to all of you precious and wonderful people. Debbie, you're the very first one pop up there this morning. Good morning to you, my dear friend. And it's good to see you there. Miss Terry, God bless you. We're praying for your sister, by the way. We love you and we love her. And you keep us posted as to how she's doing, all right? And there is our Miss Lena. Good morning with your smiley face. A little cool out there, but I like the smiley, sunny face, all right? Miss Sue, good morning to you. It is good to see you this morning. Miss Carolyn, I pray you are doing well this morning. It's good to see you. Alyssa, good morning to you. And Cam, Kara, and Cody right there along with you. I'm glad you had a great day at school yesterday. I swung by, dropped in, saw some kids running around, and but I was in and out real quick. So I'm glad you had a great day yesterday. Buddy, Julia, Shout out to Atlanta. Good afternoon to you. I hope you had a good breakfast, a good lunch, and it is so sweet and wonderful to see you there with us this morning. Rick, good morning to you. God bless you. You're right. He is risen. Aren't we glad? Miss Ruth, hello, and a shout out to Kenneth as well. God bless. It's good to see you this morning. Teresa, good morning to you. I don't know whether you're at home or at work, but good morning. I'll give you a wave too. So good morning to you. All right. As we are together and we are here. I think chapter 3 opens with Mark chapter 3, which is where we moved into yesterday, opens with another Sabbath incident. This time it's the open and dramatic healing of the man with a withered hand. Let's just take a look at that passage, if you will. Good morning, Miss Sherry. That's my sweet love. She's right upstairs above us. All right. In verses 1 through 3, it says, he entered again into a synagogue, and we knew this is sometime later than the synagogue incident we were looking at in Mark chapter 2. Luke tells us that. And a man was there whose hand was withered, dried up, shriveled up, probably paralyzed, useless. He was watching him to see, they were watching him to see if he would heal him on the Sabbath so that they might accuse him. He said to the man with the withered hand, get up and come forward. Now, Jesus' actions in this episode shows how things are beginning to heat up. A fire is lit that will ultimately become a raging inferno of holy hatred. I mean, the religious class, the Pharisees, the Sadducees will soon be on board, but for different reasons. One, the Sadducees will see him as a threat to their political stability and their the kind of power that they have under Roman rule. They'll see that as being a threat, so they'll come against him. Right now, it's the Pharisees, it's the scribes, it's that legalistic class that holds so strongly to all of the law as it has been reinterpreted by them, and they see him as a threat to their very religious stability, if you will. It's interesting that the Pharisees was more a political class than a religious class, but they were the religious watchdogs of the day. The Sadducees, who were made up of mostly priests, and they were to be the watchdogs of the religious well-being of the nation. They were more political and more tied to Rome. So that kind of gives you how twisted and upside down it was. Because of Mark's more abbreviated gospel, it goes much more quickly. It doesn't go into as much detail as Matthew and Luke and even John's gospel does. We can see how rapidly the animus is spreading among those who were within this ruling religious class, this ruling class of Pharisees and some rabbis and things, and ultimately spreading to the Sanhedrin, which is made up of both Pharisees and Sadducees. As the ruling council of 70 over the affairs of Israel. Because of Mark's brevity, we see the climax of this growing hostility. And we really see it in a rapid-fire succession of certain questions and actions that are taking place in the first two and into the third chapter. So, you know, by the opening of Mark's third chapter, we really see how rapidly that everything is disintegrating. They ask him, the first question they ever ask him is, why does he eat with tax collectors and sinners in chapter 2? And then, why do your disciples, John's disciples and the disciples of the Pharisees fast, but your disciples do not fast? And then again, in that second chapter, why are you doing what is unlawful on the Sabbath? Now, in the opening of the fourth chapter, we have that fourth statement, they were watching him so that they might accuse him. The hostility is sharpened, the synagogue door is closing. Soon Jesus isn't going to be welcomed in the synagogues. Remember, he's been teaching and preaching in the synagogues, but pretty soon he's going to be, you know, he's going to be taking it out to the people, you know, completely. And these men have now become his open and avowed enemies. But notice carefully what is said here. in that first three verses. They were watching him. And they were watching him to see if he would heal them. Notice, it doesn't enter their mind whether he could, but rather the question is, would he? You know, at this point, they're not saying, hey, if Jesus is who he says he is, let's see if he'll heal this withered man. What an exciting thing that would happen, you know, in our service. What a great opportunity, because we think it'd be awesome that this guy's hand could be healed and he could go home, provide for his family. We would see this miracle. We would watch God at work. But no, by this time, they're convinced that Jesus can, and most likely would, by the way, heal the withered hand. You see, I don't know how hard and deluded a person would have to become to hope that a man's hand would be healed, that this good person would be restored, not for his good or God's glory, but simply so they could trap and accuse Jesus. And that's exactly what they were doing. They were laying out a snare. They were laying out a trap, and this man became their snare. Knowing that the likelihood that Jesus would be would willingly walk into that trap and ensnare himself, I mean, they had to feel an exuberant glee within themselves, knowing that it's this gotcha moment. We're gonna get you. We laid the trap. You walked into it. We gotcha. Now, if they had seen Jesus do so many healings and miracles, which they had by this time, they really had no doubt about his ability to heal the withered hand. Wouldn't you think, I mean, think about it. Wouldn't you think that you might wonder, is this possibly the Messiah? Could he be, as he claims himself to be, the Son of Man? Which they knew was a designation of the Messiah right out of Daniel's prophecies. Well, we're going to continue to look at this as we come back from prayer. Father, I want to thank you so very, very much for your love and for your mercy. And Lord, for the grace that you have poured out on us. Lord, we literally live by the grace of God. We are saved by your grace. We are sustained by your grace. We persevere by your grace. This whole life is a life of grace, your unmerited favor toward us. Thank you, Lord, that day by day you pour out mercy after mercy, new and fresh each day. We owe you constant and ever-exalting praise. So we just thank you, Lord. Lord, I want to lift up Terry's sister. And she's in the hospital and the cancer has come back. Lord, sustain her. Show yourself mighty and strong and powerful in her behalf. And Lord, encourage Terry as she prays for and concerned about her sister's well-being. Encourage her. And Lord, I think of the struggles that so many of our people are going through, like Rick, who has gone through a year and a half of literally having his body ravaged by what they call long COVID. And Father, so anxious to get back into fellowship with his church family. Lord, heal that right hand and give it strength again, as he's lost the use of it because of this. And then he injured it in his fall. So raise him up and give him strength and health, Father. Thank you for the privilege we've had of praying for him and supporting him and loving him. Thank you for all those that have kept in contact and kept reaching out and letting him know that they love and pray for him. And Father, for Sadie Maybeth Sloniker, thank you for the gift of this young child. Children are a gift, Lord. And I pray for her. I pray, Lord, that she will grow strong and healthy. I pray, Lord, that as she grows up, she will grow up understanding and knowing the wonder and the mercy and the grace of God. be with her mama, be with her grandma, Lord, as they will primarily be leading her, like I think of Timothy's mother and grandmother that raised him up to know the scripture and love the Lord. Father, I pray for that, for Sadie Maybeth. God, we thank you for her. Now, God, as we go into your word, I pray that you open up the eyes of our understanding, that we may know and see and perceive what is the will of God, what we need to learn today, Father. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. All right. I remembered, flashed across my mind, I had a conversation with somebody yesterday in a text, and then we talked on the telephone concerning the Sabbath. And they had the question, you know, should people work on Sunday, you know, or not? Should they, you know, and I thought maybe I had covered that, but apparently maybe I didn't cover it strongly enough. So I promised that I would seek to answer that question in case anybody else had that question still popping in their mind. Remember, I told you that I believe. Now, everybody, you know, you are soul competent. You are you're accountable to God. But I believe that the scripture teaches pretty strongly that the Sabbath has not changed. I find nowhere in scripture, and I challenge you, if you do, please let me know, because I'm not infallible. But I find nowhere in scripture where God has lifted or changed even the Sabbath. The Sabbath is the sixth day. 6 days, or the seventh day. 6 days you will work, labor, and on the seventh you will rest. It's holy unto the Lord. So the Sabbath, you know, there are those who believe, and they believe strongly, and I value them, I love them, you know, for the passion of their belief, and for what they believed is biblical and doctrinally true, at the resurrection of Christ, that God changed the Sabbath from Saturday to Sunday, and now Sunday is a Christian Sabbath. As I said, that comes primarily from the idea and the testimony of the church. Every time, you know, it mentions frequently that the church met on the first day of the week, take a collection on the first day of the week. First day of the week is a prominent day where the church came together as a body to worship. We understand that. That is the tradition. That is the history that we have, you know, in the church. But understand, and I think we this is where we get lost in the weeds. We fail to recognize the very Judaic roots of our Christian faith. We fail to realize that the early church, by and large, 99.9% of the population of the early church was Jewish in their background. They came out of Judaism, all right? They also practiced the religious holidays, the feast days, all of that. The 120 in the upper room were functioning during the Feast of Pentecost. They were acknowledging it. They were observing it. We know that the word began to spread, you know, in Solomon's portico. That's where the church was meeting frequently, en masse, or in a large upper room at probably Mary's house. This would be the mother of John, Mark. We know these things, but we also know, according to Acts 2, that the church met day in and day out. They met daily for breaking of bread and for fellowship, for the teaching and the preaching of the word, for prayer. You know, the church met daily. Every day became the worship Sabbath, if you will. Every day was a day dedicated unto the Lord. It was a day of worship, so the church met every day. Now, Sunday became a prominent day throughout the cultural history of the church. But nowhere biblically, scripturally, do we find God saying, thou shalt make Sunday, the first day of the week, a Christian Sabbath. We just don't. We see it in tradition. We see it in our history. We acknowledge it as a day of worship. It is a day set aside that though we should be worshiping all the other 6 days of the week, Sunday becomes that day of ingathering, if you will, over the traditional course of church history, a day of ingathering where the body of Christ would come together for fellowship, for encouragement. And we know this is something that was going on by the time the Hebrew writer wrote to the writer to the Hebrews wrote and said, "Do not forsake the assembling of yourself together, which is the custom of some." That would indicate that they were getting together in assembly together, and they weren't to forsake that. All right, but it's not under the same kind of regulations as the Sabbath would have been for the Jew. And when we attempt to make Sunday a Christian Sabbath, we fall into, as did our Puritan, forefathers in our country, they did in establishing the same kind of legalistic walls around the Sabbath, giving the rules and regulations of what you could and could not do on the Christian Sabbath, on the Sunday, and it became as legalistic and as twisted and perverse as did what the Pharisees did over 400 years with the law of the Sabbath. Whether you work on Sunday or not, this is a matter of conscience between you and God. What you do, how much you do on Sunday, that's between you and God. What does your heart say? It is a heart relationship between you and God. Remember, we are living in our Sabbath rest today. Jesus Christ is our Sabbath rest, according to Hebrews. And according to other places, Jesus says he is the Lord of the Sabbath. Not Lord on the Sabbath, but of the Sabbath. And remember the key verse that I gave you out of Jesus' discussion with them is the Sabbath was made for man and not man the Sabbath. The Sabbath was given to you and me as a gift to bring rest to the body, rest to the mind, rest to the soul, if you will. And was it given to us to serve it? It is not our taskmaster, but is there to be a gift from God. Now, as I said, that being said, do I think it is wise? Do I think that it is reasonable for us to practice a Sabbath day of rest? Absolutely. God gave it to us as a gift that we might refresh and restore our bodies and our minds for another week's work, to rest after a week of working. So whether you take a Wednesday to be your day of rest, depending on your work schedules or whatever day that you can, but do I think you ought to have a day of rest every week? Yes, I do. And one of the reasons that my body suffers is because I haven't done that for years, and I'm learning the wisdom behind the rest that God had given, instructed us to have. So I'm not going to tell you what you can and cannot, what you should or should not do on Sunday. I do think you all ought to gather together and come together for worship, because that's a day we've set aside to ingather and come to get instruction and worship and fellowship and be strengthened and encouraged by our brothers and sisters. But if we have a working Sunday Sabbath, I break the Sabbath every week because I work every week, every Sunday. I preach, teach. So no, I don't believe Sunday is a Christian Sabbath. I think it is a day of ingathering and worship, a day given over to the Lord to acknowledge him. And that is in your heart between you and God. But I encourage you to fellowship with the body. I hope that answers the question. When it came up, I thought I'd answer, but I wanted to make sure that we nailed that point down, because again, it's a question that came up yesterday in asking and said, could you clarify? I hope, and I know the person's listening out there, I didn't get their permission to name them as asking the question, but I hope that clarifies and answers the question for anybody where it may be lingering. Anyway, let's get back to our study now. Let's get back, I have to watch the time, because when I get off on one of these, I can lose track of time and will not get back to where we were. So these Pharisees, at any rate, they're watching Jesus to see if he could, if he would heal the man. And that phrase, watching him, is actually a Greek phrase that means that they were not only watching him, but they were scrutinizing him. They placed him under careful observation for a purpose. And that purpose, of course, we know, was to bring an accusation against him. So what is it that Jesus does? Well, he tells us, Jesus said to the man with the withered hand, get up and come forward. Now, earlier in Mark, you remember Jesus tried to keep some of these miracles quiet. Remember when he healed the leper, he told him, don't tell anybody, go to the priest, but don't tell anybody. Went out and broadcasted it abroad. But he wanted to keep these quiet because the time really wasn't, the timing wasn't right for him to come out and in this public way that he is now. And we come to this point, he's literally inviting the man with their withered hand to come up front and center in front of everybody. Let's get you out in front of the dais so all of these religious, highbrows can see. So there's no mistake as to what's going to happen. Now, he's going to make sure everybody sees this. The gauntlet is thrown down, and now is the time has come. It is Jesus in charge. And not the hypocritical rabbis. Jesus said that every day is the day we should worship and fellowship with him. We worship in how we work and how we worship in how and we worship and how we rest in him, right? Absolutely. Absolutely. Spot on, correct. We rest in him. We work from a position of rest. We war from a position of victory. All this, we have to see ourselves in relationship to what it means to be in Christ Jesus. And as a believer, we are in him. Read Ephesians chapter 1 and mark down every time he talks about what we have in him. Now, moving on. Jesus is in charge of everything that's going on in that room. They think they're in control, but they are not. How many times do you think you're in control? I believe control, our control of things, is simply an illusion. We like to think that we're in control of matters, but we're really not. We're really not. It is God who is sovereign, God who is in control. He could have told the man, hey, listen, come see me after sunset when the Sabbath's over. Come catch me in my residence. Come on down to Peter's house and catch me there. We'll take care of this matter. But that would have been conceding, really, that the rabbis were right. And in his eyes, they'd gone too far. He knew that they were directly challenging his authority because he knew what was in their heart. Remember in, where are we? I'm not getting very far in keeping things moving forward. There we go. In Luke 8:6-8, he says, but he knew what they were thinking. And he said to the man, he knew it was in their heart. He knew what they were thinking. He knew what they were plotting and planning. So he says to the man, rise and come forward. And he rose and came forward. So he called the man to come and stand where everyone could see. And then he asked a question, not of the man, but he turns his attention to the dais there, to all these high and mighties. And he says to them, is it lawful to do good or to do harm on the Sabbath? Is it lawful, or carry that over, to save a life or to kill? Notice what they do. They keep silent. They don't answer him. Let me give you a little history lesson here that'll help you understand the question. In the days of the Maccabean revolt, nearly 200 years earlier, the Jews dealt with the question of whether it was permissible for a Jewish soldier to fight on the Sabbath or not. The enemies of the Jews had hit upon a simple strategy, the Greeks had. They would wait until the Sabbath, and they would launch then their major attacks. And the Jews would not defend themselves because it was the Sabbath. They couldn't pick up the sword or shield or fight back. And as a result, there were some terrible, terrible massacres. So the rabbis got together, they discussed, they debated the issue, and the rabbis declared then that it was permissible for a soldier to fight and protect themselves and to save lives on the Sabbath. So remember, the Pharisee system, this whole legal system, all of this grew up during that 400 years of silence. So in the midst of that, the rabbis had determined that, yes, it was right to defend yourself, to save lives, to do good. They made that distinction 200 years earlier. So Jesus is asking a related question. If it's okay to fight and protect yourself on the Sabbath and to protect other lives, then isn't it also permissible to cure a man of a disease on the Sabbath? If one is okay, isn't the other okay as well? It's the logical argument of a skilled, if you will, tactician. If it's okay to kill a man on the Sunday, then isn't it okay to cure a man on the Sabbath, rather, not Sunday? If we look at Matthew's account of this story, we see that he elaborates on this idea of doing good on the Sabbath. In chapter 12, verses 9 through 12, he says, "And departing from there," okay, "and departing from there," you got it written down on your note, I finally got it on the screen. "And departing from there, he went into their synagogue. And behold, there was a man with a withered hand. And he questioned him, saying, 'Is it lawful to heal on the Sabbath?' In order that they might accuse him." Now, put all of this together, you're getting the full story here. "And he said to them, 'What man shall there be among you who shall have one sheep, and if it falls into a pit on the Sabbath, will he not take hold of it and lift it out? Of how much more value then is a man than a sheep? So then, it is lawful to do good on the Sabbath." Let's bring it right around now and say, by all logic and reasoning, by your own standards, yes, it is lawful to do good on the Sabbath. And as he did so often, Jesus used an example from normal life to make his point. If a man's sheep fell into a pit on the Sabbath, it surely would it would last until the next day. You know, it could survive until the next day. But not a man among them would have let the bleating animal suffer. The poor animal would have been given Sabbath relief, is what it would be called. The Talmud concludes that the avoidance of animal suffering should override religious regulation. So they labeled it Sabbath relief. And the point that Jesus is making is striking. How much more value does a man have than a sheep? What has more value? The sheep or one made in the image of God? By the way, that's a good question to ask PETA. Just saying, you know. "And he said to him, 'Is it lawful to do good or to do harm on the Sabbath, to save a life or to kill?' But they kept silent." This isn't a trick question, people. He isn't trying to trap them. No, he's just simply using their own rules and regulations and bringing them out. They're trying to use their rules and regulations to trap him and accuse him. He just simply lifting up the ones they conveniently want to forget. You see, that's the way it is with us sometimes, isn't it? When truth gets into the way of our preconceived desires or ideas, well, it's more convenient to put the truth in a box and put it away and keep our own preconceived notions. One of my favorite descriptions of the Word of God is the plumb line. Amos calls it the plumb line. Now, I'm not a carpenter, you know, but I do know the value of a plumb line. And I think all of you do too. Plumb line is you tack a line up with a heavy object and it falls down. It's always going to be a straight line. So you put that against a wall that you're building, and you can tell whether that wall. And well, I've got those things that you put up that's got the bubble. You know what? Somebody write it up there and put it up there. I can't think of the name of it right now. But you can put that up against there and or lay it down. And if the bubble is in the center of the two lines, you know it's straight. You know it's level. A level, that's what it's called, a level. Well, the plumb line does the same thing. Well, the word is that plumb line. We let that word down, you know, up against our life. Thank you, Alyssa. You got it. It's a level. Terry, it's a level. I got it. I just had that brain fog for a moment. All right. But at any rate, what happens too often is we see that our life is out of plumb. It's bowing in or it's bowing out. And it takes a lot of effort to straighten that out so it's plumb with the Word of God. So what do? We close the Word of God, we put it away, and we keep our out-of-plumb life. No, when God hangs His Word down to our life, we need to make the choice to adjust our life to the Word of God and not the Word of God to our life. My life gets out of plumb. And if I try to adjust the Word of God to fit my life when it's out of plumb, I will pervert and distort the Word of God. But when I straighten my life out according to the Word, I'll never go wrong. Never. You see, this should have been an easy question for these people to answer. But of course, Jesus, we know the answer, don't we? We should do good on the Sabbath, Jesus. We should save a life, relieve suffering, and not kill on the Sabbath, Jesus. That's the answer. But Jesus had backed these religious legalists into a corner, and they had no answer. They kept silent. They knew what the answer was, but it didn't fit. You see? I counsel with people sometimes, and I show them the truth, and they know what the answer is, but it doesn't fit what they want. So they reject the answer. And greater is their misery because of it. They do. If they said, well, Jesus, of course you should do good on the Sabbath. Of course you should relieve suffering on the Sabbath. Of course there should be Sabbath relief for this man. They'd be giving him license to heal, and they just couldn't do that. They couldn't bring themselves to do that because they so desperately wanted something to accuse him with. And they knew if they said, you should do no harm on the Sabbath, that he would immediately, that you should do harm, that no, leave that man alone, let him suffer. He suffered, for years. He can suffer for another day. He knew that they would immediately be discredited. Their religious defenses had become so strong, they could not even bring themselves to say to him, Jesus, you've got to do good on the Sabbath. Now, because of this, because of their anger, because of the fact that they simply would not be honest, it angered Jesus. How do we know? Because look at verse 5. After looking around at them with anger, now, I don't know how long he stood there. And I think you could have heard a pin drop in that synagogue. He gave them plenty of time to answer. He stared at each one of them. And probably at the whole room, everybody in there. And the more he stared, the more righteous anger built up in him. And that brought, he was grieved, it says, at their hardness of heart. And he turned his attention to the man. He said to the man, stretch out your hand. And he stretched it out, and the hand was restored. What did they become in the name of religion has simply made Jesus angry, and his anger was a righteous anger. The verb tense actually says that Jesus was grieved that their hearts were becoming more and more and more hardened by the moment. The longer this went on, the more he stared at them, the more he looked at them, the harder their hearts were becoming. And that's what that verb means. Good morning, Sean. Oh, I didn't see you pop in there. Hey, hooray, good morning, grandson. Hello, Sean. Good afternoon, good evening to you. We love you, son. It is so good to see you pop up. Thank you, Terry, for saying good morning to Sean. So happy to see you. Sean's in Korea, for those that you don't know him. He is my grandson-in-law. He is my great-granddaughter Riley's daddy. He is Michaela's husband, and we love him with all of our heart. Oh, what a fine, fine young man he is. Love you. All right. It's about 0240 here. That'd be 2:40 in the morning. But it's a little chilly at 2:40 in the morning, but we love you. Oh, do we love you? All right. Remember, the verb tense actually says that Jesus is grieved that their hearts are becoming increasingly hardened. You see, every time the Bible talks about a hard heart, it's referring to the fact that when God reveals himself very openly and clearly, we have to respond to that. Either at that moment we fall down and surrender and we acknowledge him as God, or we deny the obvious and our hearts become hardened. And Jesus is saying here that the evidence for who he is so overwhelming that one more time he's going to make it so abundantly clear that they couldn't miss it. And either at that point they have to say, yes, he is the Messiah of God, he is the anointed one, he is the Christ, or they're going to choose to ignore what is so evident, and their hearts would be just get harder and harder and harder the more they reject the truth. And this is the lesson for you today, that you could put in an exclamation mark right next to these verses. Each and every one of us need to take to heart for ourselves and for our warning others to heed the word of God and come to Christ and surrender to him. And here is that universal truth. When God reveals himself, we either choose to acknowledge him and surrender, or we ignore him. We suppress the truth in unrighteousness, Paul says, and we become harder and harder and harder. Do you understand the truth? And you're going to see how this plays out as we go through this whole thing and into, even when we get into their accusing him of doing things, you know, in the name of Satan, if you will. You will see the progressive hardness of their heart till they push it too far. When God reveals himself, we either choose to acknowledge him and surrender, or we ignore him, we push the truth down, we suppress it in all unrighteousness, and the ending result is we become harder and harder and harder. In other words, God begins to lift his restraining hand upon us, turning us over to the very hardness of our own heart, and it becomes more and more calloused. That's one mighty lesson to learn from what we are seeing here in Mark 3, verses 1 through 3 and on. Father, I want to thank you for your word. Thank you, Lord, for just really, Father, telling it like it is. Pull the stops out of our ears. Lord, our spiritual ears sometimes get a lot of heavy wax buildup in them. Melt that wax so that we can hear clearly what the Spirit of God says. Sometimes our spiritual eyes begin to grow cataracts, and we ask you just to peel those away so that we can see clearly what you are doing and what you are saying. Our minds get fogged with our own agendas and our own wants, our own desires, our own preconceived notions and ideas. Lord, clear the fog away so that we can see how our preconceived ideas do not line up with your precious, infallible word, and let us accept your word. Lord, let us completely and absolutely surrender wherever and whenever we see the Word of God spelled out so clearly. And let us, by the grace of God, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, adjust our lives to fit your Word. And Lord, keep us from trying to adjust the Word to fit our lives. Now God, take the lessons we've learned today and burn them deeply within our heart and make them a part of our very, very, very person. And I think of my precious Sean. Keep him safe. Encourage him, build him up, fill him full of joy that comes from knowing you. Let him rest confidently in you, knowing that all things are in your hands and that you specially love him. And God, as we come today and we leave this time of study, let us go out with a heart intent on serving you, of seeing where you're working and joining you. God, you are gracious and good, and thank you for that. Thank you, Lord, that you have spread this Bible study from not only coast to coast, but crossed into other countries like the Philippines or France or Spain or Germany or now into Korea, even where Sean is. To you be glory, Lord, and praise always in Jesus' name. Amen. God bless you all. You have a great, wonderful day. May God just prosper in your heart and life. And may he lead you into the center of his desired purpose for you today. Oh, by the way, reach out. Let somebody know that you love them. Someone may be hurting and suffering out there. Think of Lola and I am having a hard time with names today. But think of our dear friends, Oliver, who is recuperating now from his broken hip. Think of our folks. Reach out and let them know you love them. May God bless you. Yes, Therese. Thank you, Debbie, for reminding me. Remember Therese as she heals from her fall. So pray for one another. Pray for Sean. Pray for his family who he's separated from. We love you. May God bless you today. Love one another. For, John would tell you, love is of God. May God bless you. See you tonight at 6 as we pick up our evening study, looking tonight at the Shepherd Psalm, Psalm 24. And then we will move Tanya and Kirk, Sherry said, yeah, because, you know, Tanya's having real difficulties with her MS right now and things going on in the yard and all kinds of different stuff. So keep them in your prayers as well. May God bless you. We'll see you tonight at 6 and then tomorrow back here at 9. God bless. Love all of you. Have an awesome day. Thank you, Debbie. You too. Good day.